Come, come, whoever you are, you are welcome here. No matter your age, your size, the color of your eyes, your hair, your skin, you are welcome here. No matter your gender, whom you love, how you speak, or whatever your abilities, you are welcome here. You're welcome here whether you come with laughter in your heart or tears in your eyes. You are welcome here. No matter what you've experienced in the past, no matter what awaits you in the future, you are welcome here. Whether you believe in God all the time, some of the time, or none of the time, you are welcome here. This is a community of open minds, loving hearts, and willing hands. As we gather this morning, let us pause and acknowledge that the ground upon which we gather is the ancestral and current home of the Shoshone, Paiute, Goshute, and Ute tribes. November is Native American Heritage Month, so we'll be especially lifting up and honoring the voices and perspectives of Native American peoples of North America. We strive to bring forth a new sacred dream of a community restored and a world healed to a greater wholeness. Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Tom, and my pronouns are he and him. You're very welcome with us here, as I've said. And of course, we want to extend a welcome to our people in our virtual audience as well. Thanks for joining us this morning.
This morning, as many of you know, is our Bread Communion, and this is a celebration that we have every fall to represent the goodness of the harvest and the joy of being together in community. So we put our chairs in the round, and in a moment, I'm going to have Ren come forward and help me light the chalice. And at that point, too, I'm going to invite all the children who want to come and just sort of gather here in the center so that you can have the best view. All right. So, Ren, why don't you come forward and help me light this chalice? You hold this. It smells so good over here. I'm having a hard time. Okay. So, say the words with me, everyone. We light this chalice. For the warmth of love, for the light of truth, and for the energy of action. Thank you. It is good to be together. I had technology problems this morning, so I apologize. I have to read my phone to see what we're doing. So we have a table here. Because we believe in community. We believe in the power of what is possible when we gather together as a community. We believe in what we have to give to and to receive from one another. And we are fed in relationship. And the table is our symbol.
We place this cloth on the table, because each life is interwoven with every other life. The cloth is our symbol of the love which binds us, surrounds us, comforts and covers us.
And we place a candle on the table because we believe in the light of faith, the light of hope, the light of love. The candle is our symbol of the light and our flaming chalice, which guides our search for truth and meaning.
We place flowers on the table so that we remember to see the mystery and beauty of creation, which continually surrounds us. Flowers are our symbol of the grace which springs up into our lives.
And lastly, we place this water. Gathered from among us at our water ceremony, reminding us that water is life, that our spiritual selves need refreshment as much as our physical selves do, and that in truth, there is no separation between spirit and body, except in language and in perception, for we are embodied, beloved, and whole, yet made somehow more so by our togetherness. And so our table is set. I invite you now to sing with me. From you I receive, to you I give. We're going to do this a cappella, so if you know it. And so let us begin our bread communion. In this congregation at this time, we celebrate the bread communion. And this is one of several pauses within our liturgical year, such as it is. Each of our communions, from water to bread to fire to flour, reminds us of the sacred bonds between us and the importance of community and our interdependence with one another. And all of their symbols are here with us. And so, let's see if I can do this with my phone. Sometimes technology just forces you to adapt. Breaking this bread, we celebrate our unity with one another as human beings who have been warmed by the great sun and who have lived on the earth before us and who will come after us, who have seen the greening of spring and who have stood watching wind sweep a field of wheat, who have tried to count the stars in a cloudless winter sky. Please join me now in blessing these loaves. The words are printed in your order of service. We bless these loaves. We bless this bread we have in common with one another and with all people. We bless all the things that feed us, body and heart, mind and soul. We bless these loaves. We bless these loaves. We bless these loaves. At this time, let us celebrate this communion by feasting with one another. I invite Kathleen and whoever else wants to jump up, a couple of people. Yes. Come on forward. Who else would like to come forward? Tucker. And I encourage you to grab a basket of your choice. You can use that one and you're going to pass it out. You can grab two or one. I need one person to volunteer to do the gluten-free. So this one is gluten-free. So if you need gluten-free, please raise your hand. So please partake of a piece of bread, but don't consume it quite yet. Just enjoy the feel of the bread in your hand. Feel its texture and its weight. Imagine the loving hands that made it, the sun and the rain and the butterflies that pollinated along the way. What an astonishing chain of events has occurred to bring this bread to you. For those at home in our online audience, I invite you to share any thoughts or feelings, memories, times making bread, or just your favorite type of bread in the online chat.
Every seed remembers spring planting. memories of warmth and darkness and rich black soil. Every stalk remembers that first growing glimpse of sky, stirring wind, blessing rain, and sun's caress. The whole world is green.
Every grain remembers spring, summer, and now autumn. Growing gold, cooling air, paling sun, heavy, full, pregnant. Now is the time for harvest. Every loaf remembers all of this, all that has gone before, every hand, every thing that touched it, cradles it like an infant and offers it up. Rain, soil, sun, seed, stalk, and grain, impossibly alive as nights grow long and all else withers.
And so life begets life, and life, and greater life, until the great wheel turns and spring comes round again.
Now that we have feasted and been nourished, let us sit together in silent meditation, as is our practice with one another. We will sit together for 2 minutes. And remember that meditation is practice, not perfection.
This community, our church and its many ministries are only made possible by the gifts you give of your time, talent, and treasure. We're immensely grateful for all of those who pledge monthly through our online Breeze portal. And we also have an opportunity here in our service to give and contribute financially to this work. Your gifts help to ensure that we're able to live our values of love and justice in the world outside. Part of our ministry at South Valley includes sharing our Sunday worship offerings with a charitable organization that aligns with our principles and values. For November and December, we're supporting the Children's Service Society of Utah. This organization provides coordinated care and support for children and families in our community with complex needs. Key programs include adoption and foster care support, as well as child care resources. Please join with me in reading our offertory words that are printed in your order of service. We are this church. We are its hands, its heart, its voice. Together we share the wealth of this community and sustain it with our gifts.
us such a great honor. Caro so graciously agreed to come and play for us this week, last minute, so that John could have the day to rest his voice before his recital tonight. So thank you, Tara. And thank you for your generosity. May these gifts be a blessing on South Valley and on the Children's Service Society of Utah.
Now I'd like to invite all of our young people and the young at heart to come forward and grab a comfy cushion out of here if you like. And I'm going to be walking around just a little bit during this story. So maybe if we could, once you have your cushion, set it down kind of still out so there's a little path I can walk around so I'm not stepping on your fingers. Go ahead and pick one. So glad to see all of you this morning. Not right now. Hello. Good to see you. So yeah, maybe so I know that there's not a whole lot of room here. I'll move my table a little bit, but it's a little room so I can walk around. Not right now. All right. Yeah. All right. Well, I'm so glad to see all of you this morning. Oh, here. Let me move these side to side. That'll make it a little easier. Thank you for letting me know that. We should all be able to see that. Well, our story this morning is written by a woman named Bird Baylor. And Bird Baylor was a woman who lived in the American Southwest. You need a cushion? And Bird Baylor, in her stories, regularly reminds us about the ways that the Native Americans have and still recognize that there is life in all things, not just people and animals and plants, but also in the rocks and in the sky and in the stars. And so you are going to create the pictures as you hear this story. Maybe if you want to close your eyes, you can do that. Or if you want to think about the ways that your family gathers for meals, you can do that and create some pictures in your mind. This is called The Table Where Rich People Sit. If you could see us sitting here at our old, scratched up, homemade kitchen table, you would know that we aren't rich. But my father is trying to tell us that we are. Doesn't he notice my worn out shoes, or that my little brother has patches on the pants that he wears from first grade? And why does he think that old rattletrap truck is parked by our door? You can't fool me, I say. We are poor. Would rich people sit at a table like this? My mother sort of pats the table and she says, well, we're rich and we sit here every day. Sometimes I think that I'm the only one in my family who is really sensible. Do any of you feel that way? Maybe I should mention that my parents made this table out of lumber somebody else threw away. They even had a celebration when they finished it. Now understand, I like this table just fine. All I'm saying is you can tell it didn't come from a fancy furniture store. It just doesn't look like a table where rich people would sit. But my mother thinks of if all the rulers of the world could get together at a friendly wooden table in somebody's kitchen, they would solve all of their arguments in half of the time, maybe less. And my father says it wouldn't hurt to have a lot of cookies piled up on a nice blue plate that everyone could reach without asking. But tonight, it's our kitchen, and our argument, and our family meeting, and our very spicy ginger cookies piled up on my mother's one good blue-flowered plate, exactly at the center of the table. Well, and I'm the one who called this meeting of the family, and the subject is money, and I say we don't have enough of it. I tell my parents that maybe they should both just get some better jobs so we could buy a lot of nice new things. I tell them that I look worse than anyone else at school. I hate to bring this up, I say, but it would help if you both had a little more ambition. They looked surprised. You can see they never think about the things we need. Right here, I might as well admit that my parents have some strange ideas about working. They think the only jobs worth having are jobs outdoors. They want cliffs or canyons or desert or mountains around them, wherever they work. They even always want to make sure they have a good view of the sky. They always work together, and their favorite thing is panning for gold, looking for gold in the sediment and sand in the river, yeah. Piling us into that beat up truck and heading for those rocky desert hills or back in some narrow mountain gully where all the roads are just covered coyote trails. They love to walk the wide arroyos, the dry steam beds where little flecks of gold are found. They used to tell us that the truck just sort of knew which roads to take, and the coyotes showed them where to look for gold. But I never did believe it. After a month or two out there, they always had a little bit of gold to sell, but you can tell it never made them rich. As far as I can see, it was just an excuse to camp in some beautiful wild place again. They don't mind planting fields of sweet corn or alfalfa. They like to pick chili and squash and tomatoes. They'll put up strong fences or train young wild horses. But they say they can't stand being cooped up indoors. So now, of course, my dad is asking, how many people are as lucky as we are? Me too. Me too. We are all lucky. You're right about that, Walter.
I'm not lucky.
I think you are. I think you're very lucky, Penny.
I'm luckier than her.
You're luckier than she is? Oh my goodness. But I've called this meeting, I say, and I say, I bet you could make more money working in a building somewhere in town. Remember our number one rule, my dad says, we have to see the sky. You could look through a window, I say, but they won't even think about it. Do you see what I mean about being the only sensible one? Finally, my mother says, "All right, Mountain Girl, we are going to explain how we figure our money, and you be the bookkeeper tonight." She hands us each a pencil and some yellow paper. She gives us some to my little brother, too, though he'll just sit there pretending to write when we write, or he'll draw people dancing up in the sky. And by the way, my name's not really Mountain Girl. They call me that because I was born in a cabin on the side of a mountain where they were looking for gold one summertime in Arizona. They say it was the most magical place, the most beautiful mountain they had ever climbed. Well, maybe it was, but you know how those two exaggerate. Anyway, they wanted my first sight to be of that mountainside when I was a baby, so they held me up outdoors at sunrise when I was just about 8 minutes old. The truth is, I do still like sunrise quite a lot. And my little brother, they call him Ocean Boy. They say, since I already had the best mountain for my first sight, they thought they ought to find the most beautiful ocean for him. I think they went all over Mexico looking for a place where ocean touches jungle. And they had to find a certain kind of purple-blue night sky and the exact green waves that they like. So they held up my little brother to see those waves for his very first sight. Someday we're all going back to his green ocean and my high mountain. But for now, even though they claim to be so rich, they can't take us anywhere at all. Well, no wonder I had to call this meeting about money. Can you believe my father is sitting here looking at me straight in the eye and saying, "But Mountain Girl, I thought you knew how rich we are." I say, we can't get very far in this discussion if you won't even admit that we're poor. "I'll prove it to you right now," he says. "Let's make a list of the money that we earn in a year." "How much is that?" I ask. "I'll write it down." But he says, "Not so fast. We have a lot of things to think about before we add them up." "Oh, well, what kinds of things?" I say. My mother says, "We don't just take our pay in cash, you know. We have a special plan so we get paid in sunsets, too. And in having time to hike around the canyons and look for eagle nests." But I say, "Can't you just give me one single number to write down on this paper?" So we start with $20,000. That's how much my father says it's worth to him to work outdoors where he can see the sky all day and feel the wind and smell the rain an hour before it's really raining. He says it's worth that much to be where, if he feels like singing, he can sing out loud and no one will mind. So I have just written 20,000 when my mother says, "You'd better make that 30,000 because it's at least worth another 10 to hear coyotes howling back in the hills." So I write 30,000. Then she remembers that they like to see long distances and far away mountains that change color about 10 times a day. "Well, that's worth another $5,000 to me," my mother says. I'm not surprised because my mother claims to be an expert on mountain shadows in the desert. She says that she can tell the time by the way the colors change from dawn to dark. So I scratch out what I had and write $35,000. My father thinks of something else. You know, when a cactus blooms, you should be there to watch it because it might be a color that you won't see again any other day in your entire life. How much would you say that that is worth? 50 cents. Yeah, my brother says. But they decide on another 5,000. So I write $40,000. But I had forgotten how much my father likes to make bird sounds. He can copy any bird. And while he's best at white-winged doves and ravens and red-tailed hawks and quail, he's good at eagles too and great horned owls. So of course, he has to add another 10,000 for both daybirds and nightbirds around us. So I cross out what I had and I write $50,000. Now my mother says, "Let's see what our mountain girl is worth to us." I'm beginning to catch on to their kind of thinking, so I suggest that I am worth $10,000, even though my little brother started to laugh. "Don't underestimate yourself," my father says. "Remember all those good lists that you make for us." He's right, I do. I made a list of the best books that each one of us had to read, and a list of all the ones that we'll read again. I made a list of all of the animals each one of us has seen and the ones we still want to see. out in the wild, not in a zoo. Mine is a mountain lion. I've dreamed of him 4 times, and I've already seen his track. My father chose a grizzly bear. My mother wants to see a wolf and hear it call. And my brother can't decide between a dolphin and a whale. I remember every single one because I make the lists. They end up deciding I'm worth about $1 million. I say I don't think I am, but I write it anyway. In fact, it turns out that every one of us is worth $1 million. So we have $4,050,000. Then I realize I want to add $5,000 myself for the pleasure I have wandering around this open country alone, free as a lizard, not following trails, not having a plan, just turning whatever way the wind blows me. They say, yes, that is certainly worth $5,000. So that makes $4,055,000. Finally, my brother says to put down $7 more for all the nights we get to sleep outside under the stars. We all say that $7 doesn't seem to be enough. We talk him into making it $5,000. Now my paper says $4,060,000, and we haven't even started counting actual cash. To tell the truth, the cash part doesn't seem really to matter much to me anymore. I suggest it shouldn't be on a list of our kind of riches. So, the meeting is over. The rest of them have gone outside to see the new sliver of moon, but I'm still sitting here at our beautiful homemade kitchen table with one cookie left on my mother's good blue flowered plate. I'm writing this book about us. I kind of pat the table, and I'm glad it's ours. In fact, I think the title of my book is going to be The Table Where Rich People Sit. All right. My friends, you may, if you wish, continue to sit on these cushions in this circle if you like. Or you can bring them back. We do have one more thing to do after you bring your cushions up that I'll explain in just a moment. Thank you all. Yeah, yeah. Feel free to stay up here or keep your cushion. How would you cash them in? I don't know. Thank you, friends.
That is a lot of cushions.
Right? How do they fit in there?
Yeah.
Sometimes we have to kind of give them a little push. Thanks, Brighton. All right. Thank you. I'm going to put this back in here. You can find your seat. Oh, wait. No. Goodness. Before you find your seats. So we have all of this bread here. And after our service here, we are going to enjoy some bread and soup downstairs. But if we're going to enjoy this bread, for some people, they also like to enjoy their bread with butter. And it would be really easy just to go out and get some, but I think it would be more fun if we made it ourselves. And so for each of you, inside this little jar is some cream and a little bit of salt. And so for the rest of this time that we're here before we go downstairs so that you can prepare to have some butter for your bread and probably enough that you'll be able to take home, what I'd like you to do for the rest of the time here is, in order to make this butter, what do we need to do with
it?
We need to shake it. That's right. And the best way to do this, friends, with these lids, because ooh, we want to make sure we keep these lids on nice and tight, right? Or we'll have a big mess. Yeah, exactly. So if you want to maybe take it like this, put a finger on top, and then shake it like this. And the good part, friends, is that we don't need to shake it within an inch of its life because just doing this for the rest of the time, as long as you keep going, that will be just plenty, all right? Penny, do you want one? All right. So remember, we'll leave the lids on, and for the rest of your time, sure. We're doing this, all right? Now you can go and find your seats, but keep shaking. All right.
All right, I'm going to give you a short reflection. I want to make it short because I know you're all hungry and ready to eat, but also long enough to make some butter, right? So keep making your butter. I'll keep talking and you guys keep shaking. Okay. So, who likes eating? Yes. This is Thanksgiving week, right? So we're all thinking about what food we're going to get to eat. And I want to just talk about the great privilege it is to be able to have food. It turns out that not everyone in this world has food security. Can you imagine what it would be like to not know if you're going to get another meal? Where your next piece of food might come from? This is something that happens even right here in our area. This is, but of course, it's even worse in areas where poverty is worse. What are the causes of food insecurity? And I want to talk for a minute as I introduce this. Let's all look at one piece of bread. All right, and let's think about, we've already thought a little bit about the ingredients and the plants as they grow and the abundance that the world and the earth gives us. But I want to talk for a minute about the human hands. Think about this one piece of bread that I'm holding and the human hands. Can you just, I don't even know, to be honest, how many human hands have contributed to this one piece of bread. I don't even think I could give a number. Hundreds, thousands, I don't know. I mean, if you think about all the processes, all of the people who grow the various ingredients, who process the ingredients, who ship the ingredients, and then just, of course, the final stages of actually mixing and making and putting the bread together. To me, this piece of bread and all the bread that you've eaten is a great symbol of human cooperation. This is what we do when we work together. We can do this kind of thing. We can make amazing bread. We can make food. We can cooperate. I would even argue, even if you could do it all yourself, right? Imagine that you could grow all the ingredients all by yourself in your own garden. You could process them all by yourself. I don't even think any of us are capable of doing this, by the way. But even imagine that you could, it would still require the cooperation, even in the minimal way, of people not coming and stealing your food and your crops and whatnot, right? Imagine you live in a place where that's a threat, where people might come through and actually steal your crops or ruin your fields or whatever. So even if you could do all the stuff yourself, it still requires cooperation to just leave you in peace to make your bread. And this is really the connection I want to make here, because peace is the key for prosperity, for cooperation. I've been thinking a lot about Ukraine. It's called the breadbasket of the world. It has some of the most fertile land in the world. Let me just read a little bit about Ukraine, if I can find my right note. The impact of the war, so this is obviously talking about the Russian aggression in Ukraine and the war that they're currently fighting. The impact of the war on global food markets is so severe because Ukraine is one of the top agricultural exporters in the world, possessing some of the most fertile land on earth. Ukraine is the world's largest exporter of sunflower oil. 50% of all the world exports comes from Ukraine in terms of sunflower oil. Ukraine is the third largest exporter of barley, the fourth largest exporter of maize, meaning corn, fifth largest of wheat. And most of Ukraine's wheat goes to poorer countries. So this is where we come back to the food security, like I was talking about. War has directly contributed to our food insecurity, to our higher prices because of our global markets. But of course, like I said, there's places in the world that are affected even more. The World Hunger Hotspots Report lists Burkina Faso, Mali, Palestine, South Sudan, and Sudan are the hunger hotspots of the highest concern, with significant numbers of people at risk of famine. This is the price of war. This is the price of hatred and the lack of cooperation. So as we think about the wars happening around the world, I also want us to bring it home into our lives just a little bit and think about the wars that you might be fighting in your life with yourself, or the wars that you might be fighting with your family or relatives. Is there an opportunity for peace? Is there an opportunity to lay down our arms? I'm going to read you a quote as I wrap up here from Yuval Noah Harari. He's a well-known philosopher and author who lives in Israel, and he has a unique perspective living so close to the active conflict that's happening right there right now. He said, "I think there's a choice in every ethnic conflict, whether you look to the past or look to the future. The curse of history is the attempt to correct the past, to save the past. If we could only go back to the past and save those people. And we can't. We can't. The past is gone. It cannot be changed." He goes on, "What we need to do is stop using the injuries of the past as an excuse for fresh injuries in the present, and instead think constructively about how we can heal the injuries and create peace, which will not give absolute justice to anybody, but will create a better future for everybody." So again, I invite you to think about the ways that we can put the past in the past. Think constructively about the ways that we can heal injuries so that we can sit down literally and break bread together in peace. May it be so.
Thank you, Tom. So how's that butter making going? My arm is getting very tired. I just want to make a note to people that when you do get the butter, when it starts to appear, it separates from the whey, and the whey should be thrown away. You do not want to consume that. Well, I mean, maybe you do, but I don't recommend it. So make sure you put that, when you go down to the social hall, like, pour the whey off, and then you'll have the butter remaining in your thing. Okay, I need someone to take this over for me. Thank you. Okay, so we have, we're always thinking in our community about inclusivity and how to make our spaces brighter, better, more friendly, more generous, more life-affirming for people. And a couple of months ago, we started thinking about our social hall area and about how it might be hard for people to be down there sometimes who maybe have a little neurodivergency and find it kind of overwhelming to be in overhead lights and linoleum floors and bright lights overhead. And so we started thinking about how we might make that a little bit better. And so we have now, after a couple of months, created and dedicated the first classroom to the libraries on this side. And then that there's another classroom on this side, like literally like right below me right here. And that room has now been designated as a quiet space for those that would like a quieter conversation during social hour. And so that is now open and available. And our prayer shawl group ministry, Lori and Kevin and Kate and others have been creating these wonderful blankets for us to have in the quiet room and up here in our children's area. And they made them specifically with thick, nubby yarn. And so I just want to sort of have a couple of people maybe hold these as we sort of bless and welcome these into our community and ask that you take really good care of them for us. And if I have given you a blanket, it will be perhaps your opportunity after service to go and put them down in the quiet zone. And so I just want to thank our prayer shawl committee for taking up that call and for bringing warmth, a new layer of warmth into our community. So thank you. And now I think we should close this part of our worship and go join our fellowship of soup with one another. So let us take a moment now to extinguish our chalice with one another, and then we'll sing each other downstairs. So we extinguish this chalice, but not the warmth of love, the light of truth, or the energy of action, and we hold each other in our hearts until we meet again. And all are invited for soup. After we sing, there are vegan options, there are vegetarian options, so they all will be labeled down there, and we hope you will enjoy. So Sarah's going to lead us in 1017, Building a New Way, in the teal hymnal.